Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. Maybe we'll wait a second. I'm going to go ahead and start because I already turned the thing down. Anyway, okay, so there are several biological functions of sleep, very necessary. The entity cannot survive without sleep. And this is because there are a lot of important things that happen during sleep. One is that it conserves energy. Humans, of course, are animals, and as animals, we have not always been able to protect ourselves very well. We do have major predators, or we have had major predators. So sleep is very important to us because we were sleeping during the time when our predators were awake, when they were out hunting. So one of the things that we did, and of course I've talked about this before, you have two cortisol surges. One of them is in the morning so that you can find food, 8 o'clock in the morning. The other is 4 o'clock in the afternoon so you can find some place to sleep, some safe place to sleep, potentially, of course. That might be a cave. It could be up in a tree. It could be on an island. This is something that humans have needed to do because we don't have the capability of protecting ourselves very well. We also need to regenerate cells in our body, and this takes place during sleep. Sleep aids in memory consolidation. This is when we put information into our long-term memory. So if you are one of those individuals who studies for a test at the last minute, you're not going to really remember anything for the test unless you take a nap, unless you go to sleep. Consolidation of material learned while awake, of course, is what sleep is all about. There are several sleep disorders. One of them is somnambulism. Somnambulism is sleepwalking. I told you the story about my brother last time. Another is sleep enuresis, wetting the bed. Sleep enuresis. These individuals, it tends to be genetic. There is a way to combat this. There are several techniques to use if somebody is a bedwetter. It does seem to be genetic, and it is more prevalent in males than it is in females. There is a technique now where you spray vasopressin into the nostrils before the individual goes to sleep, and that will not allow them to accumulate nearly as much urine during the night as otherwise. Researchers have discovered that REM sleep can irritate or activate gastric ulcers. Most people who have ulcers are people that are under a great deal of stress. And because of that, they do not get very restful sleep. And they produce stomach acids while they are asleep because they are so stressed out. Researchers have found that people who suffer from gastric ulcers will secrete 3 to 20 times more acid during REM as a normal person. When I was working in the laboratory, this was in Virginia. I was working in a pediatrics clinic, but it was an area where there were a lot of wealthy people, and one of the things that we discovered was that we had a number of children that were developing gastric ulcers. And mainly it was because of the stress of being wealthy, I guess, just the stress of having wealthy parents who wanted you to perform all the time. And so some of these kids were coming in with really severe gastric ulcers. Of course, if one of these things bursts through your stomach, it could kill you. It could be a bleeding ulcer. There's just a ton of different reasons. Luckily, of course, they were children, and so their capability of recovery was fairly rapid. But here we were discovering that A lot of these kids were coming down with gastric ulcers, and it was shocking to us. I had worked in the laboratory for 20 or 25 years at that point, and I had never seen anything like that before, not even when I was in the service. And dealing with adults, we didn't see that many gastric ulcers. It was really kind of odd. But they have a test now that will measure the amount of stomach acid that you're putting out through your breath. As interesting as that is, and that's one of the ways that we were detecting these gastric ulcers. Cardiovascular problems. Hospitals report that cardiac patients are more likely to die during the last 2 hours of sleep, between 4 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the morning. One of the things that I noticed, of course, this is right when they're about to wake up, when they're in REM sleep. It's almost the same as when they are awake, of course. Beta waves, they're putting off REM waves, which are very similar to beta waves. So this would be a time when they would be under stress, especially if they were having some strange dream. When I was working in the lab and working the graveyard shift, I checked more people into the morgue just before my shift ended than the people did during the day, as odd as that sounds, because most people were dying in their sleep. I mean, which is not a bad way to go, I guess. People were dying at 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. Really kind of odd. There was another oddity to people dying, and it had to do with anniversary dates. A lot of people died on New Year's Day. A lot of people died on Christmas. People would die on Easter. People would die on their anniversary date. They'd die on their birthday. What they were trying to do was hold on until they reached a select day, and that's when they would die. They would die on the day that they wanted to die, which is really kind of interesting. So research also shows a connection between angina and REM. A lot of times people will wake up with angina just means chest pain. It has to do with clogging of the arteries in the heart. And a lot of times they will wake up. Some people suffer from angina. It's congenital. They have smaller blood vessels in their heart than other individuals, and so they suffer from angina. One of those individuals was Dick Cheney, the George W. Bush's vice president, suffered from angina, and usually he'd have an angina attack right between 4 and 6 o'clock in the morning. So that was kind of a serious problem. People that suffer from insomnia, a lot of people suffer from insomnia. About a third of the population claims that they have insomnia. Really kind of odd. There are some people that suffer from insomnia because of what they're doing. Older people tend to not sleep as much as younger people. Therefore, they will claim that they have insomnia. They will go to bed until 2 o'clock in the morning and get up at 6 o'clock in the morning to read the paper or whatever. So they don't—they're not repairing themselves as they should, because of course, while you are asleep, you are repairing your body. Females tend to suffer from more insomnia than males do, for no reason whatsoever. People who smoke tobacco, of course. Tobacco is something of a stimulant, especially if you are addicted to nicotine. A lot of times these individuals will wake up with a nicotine craving during the night, and then they'll have a hard time going back to sleep. And it is a stimulant, of course, so that's kind of a problem. People that drink coffee, and if they're really sensitive to caffeine, they may suffer from insomnia. And people that drink, oddly enough, you can drink yourself into a stupor, but the reality is, unless you drink yourself into a stupor, then potentially you are activating yourself, and of course you may suffer from insomnia. Sleep state misperception is when an individual claims to have slept, but EEG tracings show that they actually did sleep. What they're doing is dreaming that they are awake. And for that reason, and the fact that the sleep is not very restful. They don't think that they're sleeping, but the reality is, of course, they are. Some insomniacs show less REM sleep and more stage 2 sleep. Of course, stage 2 is far less restful than going through the delta wave sleep and then into REM. Situational insomnia can be caused by shift work, by time zone changes, by novelty situations such as a hard motel bed. These problems may cause sleep onset insomnia, difficulty falling asleep. Usually, and I've worked a lot of graveyard, I've moved around a lot, and since I moved around a lot, I usually get the worst shifts or the shifts that nobody wants. A lot of times that involved pulling graveyard shift. And because of that, I always had difficulty adjusting my sleep schedule. At one point, I was working 3 jobs. This is when I was living in Omaha. I was working 3 jobs, and my job was to go into the hospital at, I had to draw blood at between 5 and 6 o'clock, so I had to get up. And I was like a half an hour from work, so I had to get up at 3:30, 4 o'clock in order to get into work on time. But then on the weekends, I was working graveyard shift at a hospital. So it was really tough for me to know when I was supposed to be sleeping and not sleeping. Of course, I was going to bed at 8 or 9 o'clock in order to get up through the week. And then, of course, on the weekends, everything shifted. It was really kind of tough. I had days where I would not sleep at all. At the same time, I was refereeing soccer games, so it was really, really tough. But sometimes I wasn't sleeping for 24, 48, 72 hours in a stretch, just because that was my work schedule, and it didn't work out very well. So I had sleep onset insomnia was relatively common for me. Sleep maintenance insomnia is a condition where the individual wakes up during the night and they have a difficult time staying asleep. Somebody who smokes tobacco, for example, they might have that problem. A problem that can kill you. Insomnia is probably not going to kill you. There's no reason for it to kill you, but sleep apnea sometimes will kill you. It's a problem that for people who have a form of respiratory obstruction when they sleep. As the night progresses, their oxygen level drops, and of course it drops for everybody. Your oxygen level will drop because you're not breathing as deeply as you were before. So this can be a problem, of course. The oxygen level drops, and if you've got any kind of obstruction, it will feel like you're choking yourself to death. It's a very common problem with people that are obese because they have a lot of fat in this area. Sometimes very large people have to sleep sitting up or in a reclining chair rather than a bed because if they try to lay down flat, the fat adjusts itself and presses against their breathing tube, and that can be a problem. When we were stationed in Germany, one of the things I had to do was I had to drive my car up to Bremerhaven to have it shipped back to the States. And we had 2 cars, and I had to drive up there twice. But the other thing that happened, I had to get on a train and come home. When you get up there, and it takes hours for the Army to process your car, especially if you're Air Force. Not that they are picking on Air Force personnel. They just were picking on Air Force personnel. Anyway, it always took forever to get up your paperwork work straightened out. And so you get on a train at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and you're going, I don't know, it's 500 or 600 miles. We were stationed in southern Germany. Bremerhaven is way up near Norway. I went up there in June, and it snowed. On the day that I was there, that was in June, so I almost got snowed in. we had a sports car. Anyway, so I got on the train to come back to Zweibrücken. Zweibrücken. And it took like 14 hours to get back. So I was just sitting there in the train station. And of course, everybody was trying to sleep and we were all hunched over and whatnot. And a lot of people were, you know, they're falling asleep and they're starting to snore, and then it got worse and worse and worse. All of a sudden they woke themselves up because they were choking themselves. That happened on the train. So people were falling asleep on the train with their heads back, and all of a sudden their head would loll over and, you know, they start choking themselves. Really kind of bizarre. Anyway, that kind of stuff happens. Being in a strange position will cause sleep apnea. Most modern sleeping pills activate GABA receptors, inhibiting broad regions of the brain. And they work. They work, especially in the beginning. So if you complain of having insomnia, and they say, well, let's try a sleeping pill and see if that works. For the first couple weeks, you're going to be fine. Take your sleeping pill. You feel a little drunk when you get up in the morning, but other than that, you'll be fine. What it does is it actually puts your brain to sleep by activating GABA. Now there is a problem. There can be a problem, especially if it's a pill like Halcyon. We don't really use Halcyon anymore. There are other better. Ambien, for example, is a sleep aid that we're using more and more and more. But the problem is, of course, if you use these things for an extended length of time, you develop a tolerance to it, and you have to increase the dosage. And once you start increasing the dosage, of course, now you remember, we're putting your brain to sleep here. So the higher the dosage, the more likely you will have problems with your health. And of course, we do need to continually increase the dose. Now, the problem is getting you off of this stuff, because we have to bring the dosage down slowly. Now, the other problem is going to be that it's going to kick you into insomnia. So if we lower your dosages, then all of a sudden your pills aren't working anymore. You are sleeping, but you're not sleeping enough. So you feel like you need your sleeping pills again. And that's basically the problem. It really messes up your sleep pattern by taking sleeping pills. So you're better off not doing it. Or if you're going to take sleeping pills, only take them for a couple of weeks and never increase the dosage. If you increase the dosage, now you're hooked, and the rebound effect is going to be fairly severe when we try to get you off of them. What do? They tend to reduce REM sleep, which accumulates with continued usage, causing an unpleasant rebound with cessation, of course. So it changes your REM sleep. Now we got a problem. The increase in GABA stays with the individual even when they're awake, causing a drowsy state called sleep drunkenness. And the more you're taking, of course, the worse this is. So sometimes because you're taking sleeping pills, you act like you're drunk for the first 4 hours after being awake. You wake up at 6 o'clock. For the next 4 hours, you're kind of stumbling around like you're inebriated or something. So you're better off just staying away from this stuff. Do something else. There's a lot of different ways to put yourself to sleep. Try anything other than sleeping pills. The sleeping pills really do work, though. Some researchers have suggested that the use of melatonin, the hormone that is released by the pineal gland, to maintain the individual's circadian rhythm. Melatonin lowers your body temperature, it reduces arousal and causes drowsiness. It really does do this. It really doesn't work very well as a sleeping pill. It's not like you can take melatonin one time and it's going to work. What it's going to do is make you feel sleepy. And potentially you'll go to sleep, but as a sleeping pill, it doesn't really work as well as increasing your GABA level does. Another method is to increase the level of serotonin in the system by administering tryptophan. Tryptophan, where do we find tryptophan? We find it in animal fat. So if you, especially if it's warm, it gets into your system very rapidly. So drinking warm milk works. Eating cheese before you go to bed works. Anything with animal fat in it, eating a piece of bacon, all that stuff works. It's got tryptophan. Tryptophan is a precursor for serotonin. Therefore, if you consume animal fat before you go to bed, it should put you to sleep. It'll increase your serotonin level, which will make you sleepy. And this stuff kind of works. Some people are hypersensitive. I've only met one person that was hypersensitive to tryptophan. It was an individual that one of my students back in up in Montana. And she discovered this she said cheap bastard. She was so cheap. Free food, boy, I'll tell you what, she was there. She would just scarf it right down. Anyway, and she was a funny, really funny lady. One day they had pizza, and of course she has all these dietary restrictions and whatnot. So she could only eat the cheese pizza. And so here she is, you know, they've got all these pizzas laying around, and people are taking a piece and going back and sitting down. No, she takes a whole large cheese pizza. Won't let, you know, she's like a dog fighting people off trying to get a piece of pizza. And here she eats the whole damn thing. Then she gets in her car to drive home, and she falls asleep while she's driving because she's so sensitive to tryptophan. Runs off the road and through a fence, and she tried to sue the school because they fed her cheese pizza. just a goofy, goofy lady. Anyway, she's really sensitive to tryptophan, so we had to keep her away from cheese, which was one of her favorite things. She was fine if she ate cheese at home because she'd just fall asleep, you know, sitting on the couch or whatever. But she actually fell asleep driving her car, so that was kind of a problem. She didn't kill herself. Funny lady. Narcolepsy. Narcolepsy is an affliction where the individual has sudden attacks of sleep that last for 5 to 30 minutes when they should be awake. Usually happens about every 90 minutes, or can happen every 90 minutes. These individuals are different from normal people because they go into REM sleep at the onset of their sleep patterns instead of after 90 minutes. So they go into REM right away. Most people go into alpha wave, theta wave, delta wave, and then they go into REM. But these people pop into REM almost right away. Now the problem with being in REM sleep is that your muscle tone, you lose your muscle tone, so you don't have the ability to maintain your posture. If you're in delta wave sleep, of course you can, that's when you wet the bed, that's when you sleepwalk, that's when you sleep talk, but you can't do that during REM sleep. So these individuals are paralyzed as soon as they fall asleep. These individuals display cataplexy, loss of muscle tone, sensory hallucinations, and sleep paralysis. The problem is often triggered when the individual becomes excited. So as odd as that sounds, most individuals, when they get excited, of course, they wake up more. These individuals, as soon as they get excited, they drop off to sleep. I've got a couple films to show you in just a second, and you'll see what I'm talking about. So the more excited they are, the more likely they'll fall asleep. It has been discovered that there are several breeds of dog with mutated genes that cause the orexin neuropeptide to malfunction. One of the groups is Doberman Pinschers, of course. These are Doberman Pinschers. Labrador Retrievers and Dachshunds are the three breeds that have this mutation that we have seen. So if you have a dog that's a Doberman Pinscher, potentially they have narcolepsy or a Dachshund. And of course, these are two German breeds, and the Labradors actually initially came from Germany. Labrador Retrievers, even though Labrador is up in Canada. But these are all three actually German breeds. Researchers have also produced mice without the orexin receptor who display similar symptoms. Really kind of fascinating stuff, this narcolepsy, if you've ever known anybody with narcolepsy. When I was in the service, I was surfing with a guy that we discovered he had narcolepsy. So and it was kind of bizarre. Here we are, we're medics. So anytime a situation happened in the emergency room, of course, we'd all run down to the emergency room to see if we could help. This guy would not, because if he got excited, he just sat down in the chair and fell asleep. So it was really kind of bizarre. They boarded him out of the service. You can treat this with stimulants, but as far as he was concerned, of course, you don't want to be juicing up all your military personnel. So narcolepsy is not one of those things you want all your soldiers to have. Of course, if you've got a soldier with a weapon and they're on the firing line, as soon as the enemy attacks, these guys would fall asleep. So that wouldn't work very well at all. The cells that produce orexin reside in the hypothalamus. Recent rodent studies indicate that these cells connect to brain regions that are involved in sleep and wakefulness, including the locus coeruleus, the raphe nuclei, the tuberomammillary nucleus, and the pontine reticular formation, among others. This evidence suggests that normally orexin helps the sleep and wakefulness areas carry out their jobs. The orexin-related abnormalities may impair their functions, and that's what narcolepsy is. Now let me show you what it looks like. It's just kind of fascinating. Let me do mean fiance first, so you can actually see this person falling out, I think. Is he talking? Yeah, he's talking.
All right, Anthony has this little tape for the problem sheet. And here's our clips. Okay, right now, me and my brother are going to scare my fiancé, because my fiancé has this little problem sheet, and she has narcolepsy, and whether she gets scared or she gets really excited, she tends to pass out. So what I did is have my brother go outside the door, and I said a certain word, he's going to bust into the door, and she needs some scare, and we're hoping that she can pass out. So let's see what happens here.
Believe this? It's his fiance.
It's horrible.
Hey. What are you doing?
Seeing my kid from Disneyland.
Mm-hmm. I'm using the camera to do this next.
Yeah, what are you doing?
I actually have a question for you.
I'm
side notes, I was a pretty good basketball player. I had really good grades. I had a pretty good social life. I went out with my friends all the time. After I was diagnosed, that pretty much all went down the drain. I found out I had narcolepsy. It was my freshman year in college. I was playing basketball, and I was running down the court, and I was calling for the ball. And I got really, really excited. And the next thing I know, I'm on the ground, asleep, and I woke up, and I was like, what just happened? And I watched the tape, and it was the weirdest looking thing I've ever seen in my life. I have fallen asleep in many inappropriate places, while including the basketball court, like I said earlier. Another bar, going to class, in class.
I've never seen this before.
People
falling asleep.
Yeah, right. Narcolepsy.
I've also fallen asleep while driving.
Oh, nice.
During an interview, pretty much everywhere, at least once or twice. Whenever I'm like walking, and I have nothing to hold on to or anything, I pretty much just go on and then I'm next to the wall. So I'm embarrassing, I just see people walk by wondering what. There's a girl sleeping against the wall and the wall. Unfortunately, I can't do a lot of things that other people my age get to do. I can't swim. I can't ride a bike. I'm not allowed to drive. I can't have intimate relationships. Thank you very much. Narcolepsy is not a joke. Unfortunately, there is no cure for it. And they do not know what causes it. So until they find a cure, I'm just going to have to suffer through this.
She can't drive. And she can't swim. Mm-hmm. And she can't, yeah.
She can't have a partner.
No, if she tries to have sex, she falls asleep during sex. I can't remember what this was. That's what narcolepsy looks like. It's very real.
How many sides is it on? What causes disease?
FK.
How many letters?
Human brain waves.
Okay, anyway, and that's the end of chapter 14. Narcolepsy, just fascinating stuff.
And where was she from? Where?
She's from back east, but I mean, we see narcolepsy all over the place.
Oh. I don't really know anybody seen it.
Well, usually they don't talk about it, and it's possible that we don't see it nearly as much in this population as we do in other populations. It may be just a white person's disease. I don't know. I've never really seen statistics on who gets it and who doesn't get it. As she said, when they first diagnosed it, she was playing basketball. And she was going for layups. She just collapsed and fell asleep on the court during a basketball game.
But for some people that I know, like some people like to drive. They drive all the time, like me. They get very sleepy.
Oh, sure.
They get so sleepy, you can't right. drive anymore.
Yeah, that's not good. That's just boredom, I think. yeah. I'll get everybody. Okay. Chapter 15, emotions, aggression, and stress. Fascinating chapter. One of my favorites. We have emotions for a lot of different reasons. reasons, but four basic reasons that we have emotions are because it shows us what feelings we are feeling at the time. It drives us into action. It makes us do things. If we need to fight or flee, of course, we have our physiological arousal, and then, of course, it motivates us. Emotions do often trigger action and are intensified by the presence of these feelings. The facial expressions will warn the people around us. If we saw somebody who was scared because there was somebody wandering around with a knife, potentially you'd hear them screaming or yelling. Somebody would be yelling. But if not, we would see the looks on their faces, and of course we would be aroused by what we saw. So facial expressions actually demonstrate to others, and it warns them. It's a warning mechanism. So facial expressions are extremely important. Intensity. Emotions tend to have intensities from low to high. For example, happiness to joy to ecstasy, regard to affection to adoration, apprehension to fear to terror, distraction, surprise to amazement, pensiveness to sadness to grief, boredom to disgust to loathing, annoyance to anger to rage, alertness to expectation to vigilance. And of course, these are all increasing levels of emotion that we can have. Most people try to control their emotions. For that reason, there are people, especially collectivist people that live in collectivist countries. We don't see a lot of facial expression from them, but other individuals, of course, they demonstrate their feelings very much in their faces. So we can see these facial expressions depending on who the individual is that we're dealing with. Reading literature pre-20th century, it was fairly obvious that folk psychology felt that the feelings were caused by the physical reaction. So we have the physical reaction, and then we have the feelings are created from that physical reaction. So if you're smiling, if you have your face in a smile, then eventually you'll feel happy, and so the smile will become real. So according to 20th century folk psychology, the feelings come after the physical reactions. And of course, that was part of what William James and Carl Lang were saying. The James-Lang theory is really kind of interesting. James, of course, is an American psychologist. Carl Lang is a Swedish psychologist. And they came up with the theory at the same time, and they published almost simultaneously, despite the fact that they hadn't communicated with one another. They feel that feelings are a reaction to the physical changes. Thus, if you flee from an enemy, it causes fear, and smiling causes happiness, according to James and Lang. James and Lang were aware that often there is a delay in feelings after the physiological response. If you've ever been really scared, and you probably ran away, and then all of a sudden you had a really strong reaction to it. And we see this all the time. You go through some kind of a trauma, and of course you survive the trauma, and then afterwards you break down and you start crying or doing whatever. That we see that a lot. So James and Lang makes a lot of sense. James and Lang were at the beginning of the 20th century. Cannon and Bard read James and Lang, and they thought, well, you know, I've done experiments where it doesn't fit that way. So Walter Cannon and Philip Bard, they came up with a new theory. Cannon and Bard discovered that the experience of the emotion started before the autonomic changes. So you really didn't, things didn't really change until you had the emotional feelings. Not only that, but often the autonomic changes are identical for different emotions, readying the individual for fight or flight. So you don't know if you're going to fight or you don't know if you're going to flee. You're in a dangerous situation. You're trying to decide what to do. The emotions are exactly the same. The feelings are exactly the same. And of course, the reaction all depends on what you decide to do. Cannon and Bard felt that it was the cerebral cortex's responsibility to find the appropriate emotion to fit the circumstance. So sometimes you had a reaction and the emotion wasn't attached to it. Work by Stanley Schachter showed that both theories are correct in select circumstances and incorrect in select circumstances. Schachter decided that what he was going to do, he's going to inject individuals with adrenaline or epinephrine. That is the hormone that is circulated through your system during a fight or flight situation. So what he did, he injected these individuals with a hormone that made them have an emotional reaction and also have a physical reaction. Now the interesting thing was that when he did this, he proved that the hormone would create an emotional reaction. So the hormone was actually inducing a feeling. It was inducing an emotion. However, he discovered that if he had a confederate with the individual when he injected them, that confederate could change the emotion. So he could, if they showed surprise, then the individual would have an extreme reaction of surprise. If they got angry, then that individual would have an extreme reaction, and they would get angry. So he discovered that it really didn't, the adrenaline just made you have extreme emotions, but it also was controllable by what was happening around them. So people will react to the emotions that they see around them. So Stanley Schachter actually proved that both Cannon and Bard and James and Lang were both correct, but it all depends on the circumstance. As if we look at these two pictures, these two facial expressions, we can probably discern what these individuals are feeling or not. What about this lady? What's going on with this chick? What's going on? What is she feeling?
Annoyed.
Annoyed? How about, is this baby annoyed?
Happy.
Happy and annoyed. Okay, thank you. How about the guy on the left, number three?
Furious.
Sorry?
Disgusted?
Okay. How about the guy on the right, number four? What's going on with the number four guy? Can you see anything from his facial expression?
It can't be surprise.
Doesn't look like surprise to me. I wouldn't think surprise.
Disagreeing.
Sorry?
Disagreeing?
Okay. How about number five?
Upset.
Upset.
Angry.
Frustration.
Upset.
Frustration? Okay. How about number six?
Like a loss. Grief. Grief.
Grief? Okay. How about number seven?
Disgusted.
Disgusted. How about number eight?
Scared.
Fear?
Fear.
How about nine?
Lonely.
Okay. How about 10?
Shocked.
What?
Shocked.
How about number 11?
Surprised.
She's not yawning? How about number 12?
She's
happy. She's young.
No.
Okay, how about 13?
Lonely.
Okay, how about number 14?
Confused. Or thinking.
This is weird. Up north, of course, I put this lecture together up north. When I showed this picture, everybody said exactly the same thing. But down here, you guys don't have the same, you don't recognize the same thing. It's really kind of fast.
What did they say over there?
They said she was snapping her eyes at people. Eye snapping. She's eye snapping.
Oh.
Yeah, she's... I don't know if you guys do this or not, but it's real a very common thing to up north. I've got a couple of students in my next class from up north. I'll show them this picture. They'll both recognize it almost immediately.
Oh.
As funny as that is. Okay, number 15.
Happy.
How about number 16?
Amazed.
Okay. Number 17.
Happy.
How about number 18?
Embarrassed.
Well, possibly. Okay. Okay. There are 7 facial expressions that are recognized in almost all cultures around the world. Anger, sadness, happiness, fear, disgust, surprise, and contempt. As interesting as that is. Let me go back over these. Okay. One is concerned, 2 is happy, 3 is disgust, 4 is a fake smile. As confusing as that is. 5, this is really weird. Men get number 5 almost every time. Women rarely get number 5. This guy is so angry that he's baring his teeth. Well, he's beyond anger. It's rage. This guy is enraged. But women don't get this at all. It's bizarre. Or not. Who teaches us our facial expressions? We have to learn at some place. And babies will start learning facial expressions almost right away.
From the parents.
They do. It's from the parents. Well, who spends more time with the kids?
Teacher? Mom. Oh, no.
Yeah.
No.
The mom? Oh. Yeah, so they learn it from their mother. And as it turns out, mothers train their daughters differently than they train their sons, as it turns out.
Oh, yeah.
It's really kind of strange. Of course, the father's in the whole mix as well. Little boys, of course, they play fight all the time. I see my dogs do this. My dogs are just constantly fighting. But they're not really fighting. They're not really trying to hurt each other. They're just play fighting. And little boys do this a lot. Little girls don't do this hardly at all. So little boys learn what that means. That means back off, leave me alone. But little girls, of course, don't learn this because when is their mother going to show them this facial expression? And little girls don't play fight hardly at all. Little boys play fight on a continual basis. So little boys know what this is. And they know that this means back off. Back off because I'm so angry that you never know what's going to happen next. But little girls don't. Now, this may be one of the reasons why there's so much spousal abuse, because women don't get it. I mean, they don't know this facial expression. Even if I saw a small person with this facial expression, I'd back off from it. Why? Because they're so angry that something's going to happen. Something negative is going to happen. We just had that church shooting in Texas. And possibly somebody should have recognized that this guy was so angry that he was ready to kill. And that's enraged, and that's actually the facial expression he's showing. The guy on the right is disgust, and we're going to talk about disgust in just a second. Number 7 is disgust as well. Number 8 is fear. Number 9 is concern. Number 10 is surprise. Or how do we know surprise? It's the eyes. A lot of times we can look at people's eyes and we can tell what's going on. That's a fake smile. Why? Because his eyes on it aren't involved in the smile. Okay. Fear or surprise, the lady on the right, I'm not exactly sure what she's upright and she's winking at people. I don't know, it's something prurient, I'm sure. Boredom, number 13 is boredom. Number 14 is she's snapping her eyes at people. And I don't know if you've ever seen anybody do this, but you say something and all of a sudden they don't move their head, they just flip their eyes over at you. That's called snapping your eyes. Evidently it's very common up north, not so common down here. Number 15, once again, if we look at the eyes, we can tell the difference between a fake smile and a real smile. The one on the left is more real than the one on the right. There, she's smiling with both of them. She's also showing her teeth. Anytime you're showing your teeth, of course, it is more likely a real smile. It's actually the same person. The guy on the left, you can see how much we can see his teeth. Not only can we see his teeth, but we also see him crinkling his eyes. And the lady on the right, of course, isn't using her eyes. So that is one of the differences. Let me show you a film.
I do that sometimes. I just smile.
What is that?
Yes, smile.
You
can't
take a selfie just by saying take a selfie.
You're not smiling with your teeth. It's not a real smile.
Okay.
Okay. Now these are the seven expressions. Anger. Of course, he's got his teeth bared. So anytime you have your teeth bared, it could be rage.
It's 9 o'clock on a Saturday. Break the crowd showing. There's an old man sitting next to me.
Contempt.
Yeah, wait a second. Okay, anyway, well, I'll go back
a little bit. Bush. Yeah. Is that a fake smile?
I can't remember. Lower lips turned down. Mouth is open. Tongue is protruding. Upper lip is raised.
Thank you.
there's a reason for all of these things, okay, this is anger. Okay, he's trying. Remember, we do this for a couple different reasons. One reason is because we're trying to display. We're trying to show other individuals what we're feeling. Very important. So this is anger. When the mouth is compressed, of course, when we can't see the person's lips, that is an indication that the guy is really upset. Nostrils are raised. The brow is furrowed. Of course, we can't see. Okay, the head is erect. Now, there's a reason why the head is erect. If somebody's angry, they're trying to warn other people away from them. So they make themselves as large as they possibly can. If you've ever watched a cat that was about to be attacked, the cat gets to be, it arches its back and all of its fur puff out. So it looks as big as it possibly can be. Humans do exactly the same thing. We try to be as big as we possibly can. So one of the things that happens when we are angry and we're trying to warn somebody away from us is we try to look as imposing as we possibly can. So we stand up as tall as we possibly can. We have a mean look on our faces where we try to make ourselves look as big as we possibly can. And that will keep them from attacking us. This is anger. This guy is really upset. So potentially he's about to attack somebody. And that's what he's trying to do. A lot of animals display anger. They look like they're ready to fight all the time, but the reality is they fight very little. And the reason is because one of the animals backs down. Humans are the same way. We don't want to get hurt. I still have a dog. I still have this dog. He's huge, and he hates coyotes. When we lived in Montana, he would chase off packs of coyotes all by himself. Well, the coyotes, if they all got together, they could all chase him away. I mean, they could kill him because, you know, coyotes are a pretty tough creature. But the reality was, my dog was so big that they were afraid to attack him because of the way he displayed himself. And of course, each coyote if he attacked one of the coyotes, he could kill that coyote individually. But as a pack, of course, they could do a lot of damage to it. But at the same time, each individual coyote was afraid of to attack him because he weighed twice as much as they did. He was taller than they were. His teeth weren't especially larger than theirs, but his display was so fearsome that they wouldn't attack him, despite the fact that altogether they could have done a lot of damage to it. But because he was so large, because his display was so fearsome, they wouldn't attack him. And of course, that's what humans are trying to do. They're trying to show the other individual, if you attack me, then you're going to get hurt. Even if I don't win, you're going to get hurt. Contempt. And of course, this is recognized all over as well. You're not paying attention to the person. You're looking away. Okay, disgust is kind of interesting. What kind of things are we disgusted by?
Snarky going on. Happenings.
What kind of things would disgust us? What's the most disgusting thing you can think of?
A dead animal.
Dead animal. Okay. So it's smelt. Actually, it's the smell. So all we're doing is we're displaying our disgust at the way things smell. So when we're talking about disgust, what we're doing is we're trying to close our noses is actually what we're doing. So anytime you see somebody that looks disgusted, they're actually moving their face around so that they can't smell very well. They're moving the lip up so that they smell their lip rather than they smell anything else. So that's what disgust is all about, is trying to get rid of smells. So as we see them, their mouth is open. You actually can smell through your mouth. It's part of your palate. There's a taste. And as you can see, he's got his lip up against his nose. And his nose is pulled up as far as possible. Okay, fear. Remember, we're trying to display. So we're closing our eyes. We're covering our eyes. Our eyes are big. Our eyes are wide open. Our mouth is open. And this is a display to other people that we're afraid. We pull back our lips so that our mouth is as wide as it possibly can be. So the two things that show fear or surprise, the two things that show fear and surprise are our mouths being as wide open as they possibly can be, and our eyes being as wide open as they could possibly be. So we're not only showing, what we're doing is we're displaying to other people our feelings, and our feelings are fear. We're afraid, and we're trying to show them so that they will be warned that something fearful is around. So we have our mouths open. It's one of the reasons why we yell if we're afraid. Now, this is happiness, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. So there's two times when we show our teeth. One is rage, and the other is happiness. So this is a smile.
And he's quick with a joke, or to light up your smoke.
But of course, happiness is also shown in the eyes. Our eyes are closed, are crinkled. And that shows that it's real. The reason is because our muscles are pulling up. If you ever watched a really funny movie and laughed a lot during the movie, you were probably smiling when you weren't laughing. And for that reason, your face was tired after you finished. Sometimes you'll get cramps in your face because you've been laughing so much. I don't know if that's ever happened to you. And people will say, yeah, I laughed so hard my face hurt. Well, that's what they're talking about, is the fact that they are laughing a lot. The other thing is that if you smile a lot because you're happy, if you don't smile normally, then your muscles are kind of out of practice, and so they get tired, and of course the rest of it. Once we've got sadness, and then what's the last one? Surprise. Once again, surprise. We've got we're trying to display to other individuals. So it's a lot of eyes and a lot of mouth. So we're trying to display to a select individual that is what's going on. So all of these are very logical situations. These are facial expressions. This shows you how to read body language. I'm going to just say. Okay, facial expressions are created by two sets of facial muscles, and actually there are three, but one of them is fairly neutral. The superficial facial muscles, they change the shape of your mouth, your eyes, or nose, and they pull on the attached skin all around it. The frontalis muscle wrinkles the forehead and raises the eyebrows, and of course all of this is very important for you to display emotions. Your deep facial muscles attach to the skeletal structures of the head. They enable the individual to chew. The masseter is the most powerful jaw. It is the powerful jaw muscle. The grizzly bear has such a strong masseter that it can crush a bowling ball. That's how strong his jaws are. So you don't want to mess with a grizzly bear. He can rip your arm off. Literally, he can rip your arm off. He can bite your arm off if he wanted to. Now, grizzly bears usually don't eat humans, especially, they don't usually kill things to eat them. Bears aren't that way. They usually, a bear will trying to protect itself if it attacks a human, but they don't usually do a lot of damage to the human. They just kill them. Human facial muscles are innervated by two cranial nerves. The V2 innervates the superficial muscles of the facial expression. The trigeminal nerve innervates muscles that move the jaw. And as you can see, we have the V3, the V2, and the V1. The V1 doesn't do a whole lot. It's right in the middle of your face. But your facial expression is right here in the V2. That's where all your facial expression is. And that controls your nose, it controls your mouth, it controls your eyes. And because of that, of course, it shows you all your facial expressions. Your right and left nerves are completely independent of one another. That's why if you have a stroke, of course, half of your face is giving no facial expression. The other half is show expression. This allows you to wink. It allows you to crinkle one side of your face. And people with strong facial expressions, of course, they practice moving one side and the other. Does anybody can't wink with one eye? Some people can only wink with the left eye or the right eye.
I can only close this eye.
Oh, really?
But this side is sort of harder.
Yeah, you don't practice enough. You need to practice. when I was growing up, my mother didn't have facial expressions a lot, but my dad did, and he would do that at the dinner table. He'd make facial expressions showing us how he felt. Didn't talk a lot, but he had all these amazing facial expressions. So I have found that I do exactly the same things like dad.
Winking at another person, like a male, winking to a female, does that mean they like each other's, or he likes her?
Depends on the culture, I guess. Okay. It can mean they've got a secret between the two of them. It doesn't have
admire that person.
Well, potentially, but it also can mean that it just is a way of showing them that there's something between the two of them. It doesn't have to be romantic. It could be a secret. It can be,
just feelings of emotion.
Doesn't have to be a feeling. It could just be an idea.
That's
a possibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it really all depends on the culture. Each culture is different. In some cultures, you don't want to wink at somebody. You know, in the Western world, if you wink at somebody, it's a sign of playfulness. It can be a sign of playfulness. It doesn't have to mean anything is romantic, but if you do the same thing in Japan, it means I want to have sex with you. So you have to be kind of careful. You know, it really all depends on the culture that you're dealing with as to what you can do. You know, the hand gestures and the facial expressions. You know, all of these things mean different things in different
places. Well, the first time anybody winked at me, I didn't think of it anyway because I didn't really know what it meant.
Well, it's not part of your culture.
Yeah.
Really all depends on the culture.
Yeah.
Bell's palsy is caused by an irritation of the nerves on the side of your face. Depending on where the Bell's palsy originates, just a small portion of the entire side of the face can be affected. Dental work often causes the problem, but the condition is rarely permanent. Bell's palsy usually means that you can't have any facial expressions. It's paralyzed. In essence, it's paralyzed. It's kind of like having a stroke, where you are paralyzed on one side of your body. But Bell's palsy, of course, will go away. It does go away. All it means is that there is something irritating that nerve. You can catch the flu and get Bell's palsy. I've seen that a lot. Or you had a guy that caught a cold in his nerves, and it was just the most bizarre thing in the world. So as long as his nose was running, because he had a cold, it affected that nerve, and it looked like he had a stroke. This is when I was in the service, and this guy had Bell's palsy. Another guy that worked right beside him One guy's left side was paralyzed because of his cold. The other guy's right side was paralyzed because of dental work that he had done, about 3 months before. And they kept telling him that it would improve. I was there for 6 months. I worked with him for 6 months, and it didn't improve the entire 6 months I was there. I understand that later, talking about him, Bell's palsy did go away, but it took about a year for it to go away. So it really all depends on what the problem is. All it is an irritation of the nerve or a swelling in that area. So that's what causes Bell's palsy. Through studies with animals and emotionally disturbed humans, researchers discovered an area of the brain that deals with emotion, and the limbic system in the center of the brain seems to control emotion. So that is the reptilian brain. That's the most ancient part of our brains, is the limbic system. So we get our emotions from that portion of our brains. The limbic system includes the basal forebrain nuclei, the mammillary body, the olfactory bulb, the amygdala, the hippocampus, the parahippocampal gyrus, the cingulate gyrus, the anterior nucleus of the dorsal thalamus. Tons of stuff take place in this area of the brain. So this is really quite an important area in your brain. We're going to stop right here. It's time to stop. But, of course, we'll pick this up next time. On what day is today? Tuesday? Thursday.